Tomorrow is Erev Shavuos and Yetz Hashem, and it would be nice really to talk a little bit about Shavuos, except that nobody's going to have time to listen anyway before Shavuos. I maybe should have made the shiur yesterday. I'll call upon him, so it's a little late to talk about Shavuos, but the fact is that we are sort of talking about the Aseres Hadibros, and to see why these Aseres Hadibros, what their function was. And we showed in the last two shiurim that it wasn't a mitzvah function, because actually according to the Rambam there are 14 mitzvahs in the Aseres Hadibros. According to the Ramban, l'chol hapochus, there are 11 mitzvahs. So we decided that Dibros was something else, that Dibros is ki'ilu the constitution, the 10 yesoidas of the constitution of a mamleches koyanim v'goy kodesh. So 2 weeks ago we talked about Anoichi, and last week we talked about Lo Yilecha, how both these mitzvahs go beyond their mitzvah status to make them have the character of a Dibra, which means giving them, imbuing them with a character which can be defined as being a fundamental yesod in the binyan of a mamleches koyanim v'goy kodesh. So this week in Yetz Hashem after Shavuos, it's going to be Parshas Nosai. And the Meister, that is a little bit connected with the mitzvah of Kibud Av Va'Em. And so, although Al Pi Seder, we should be talking about Leisisa and then Shabbos, but I'll jump to Kibud Av Va'Em. Maybe in subsequent weeks we'll get back to those other two mitzvahs. Now, Kibud Av Va'Em, Avada Gevissa, Yesoidus de Kazach, the question is, why does it have to figure in the Aseres Hadibros? Again, we must assume that there is something beyond its mitzvah status which gives it a place in the Aseres Hadibros. The fact is that there are lots of mitzvahs which are very, very important yesoidas. Why should Kibbut Avraham be dafke here? For example, there's also a mitzvah of Yiras, Ish Imavov of Tiro in Parshas Kedoshim. So if Yiras Avraham can be outside Aseres Hadibros, so then Kibbut Avraham can also be outside Aseres Hadibros. Conversely, we should ask, don't know whether you can ask such a question, but Be'etzem, it's something which certainly is interesting, that if we assume that the relationship of the Av, of the son to the Av, makes it into the Aseres Hadibros, so why is it only the Kabed and not the Meira? Why only the Kovod and not the Meira? The two different categories of mitzvahs, Kibud is Machileo, Mashkeo, Manilo, Malbisho, Maitzio, Machnisoi, those are the mitzvahs I say, the Ishima Bo'ev Tiro is Shlo Yeshe bin Koimer, Shlo Yamad bin Koimer, Shlo Yista is the Vorov, those are the Loisases. Why is it Taka? I don't know to what extent it's a legitimate question, but it seems to me to be a legitimate question to ask, why would Kibud Avraham have a place in the Aseres Hadibros, but Yira Moira Avraham should not have a place in the Aseres Hadibros? I think it's worth asking. So what does Kibud Avraham have to do with Parshas Nosai? Now the emes is that in Parshas Nosai we have this strange phenomenon that in the middle of the narrative we have three, maybe four blocks of mitzvahs which really one would suppose don't really belong there. First we have the Parsha of Gezel HaGer. What happens when you guzzle from a ger and then he dies without yoshim? What happens to the property? Then you have the Parsha of Soita. Then you have the Parsha of Nozia. Those three Parshias, they really don't seem to fit into Sefer Bamidbar. The Sefer Bamidbar is a narrative Sefer. So why in the middle over here do these three mitzvahs come over here? they would fit very well into Mishpatim, they would fit very well in Bayikra, into Kedoshim, into Dvorim, in Kisese. But what are they doing over here in the middle of Nosai, where we just got through with the Masr of the Bnei Gershon and the Bnei Merari, and now we're going on to the Chanukah HaMizbeach. So what do these mitzvahs have to do over here, apparently in the middle of nowhere? Now, it's interesting that Rashi does not consider this something that he has to deal with. He doesn't deal with that. Rashi does bring the Chazal, that why does Soita follow Gezel HaGer? And Rashi explains, because Gezel HaGer goes to the Kohen, so it's one of the Matnos Kohuna, so if you don't give it to the Kohen, so your punishment will be that you'll need the Kohen when your Isha becomes a Sofek Soita. So Rashi explains why B follows A. Then Rashi explains why C follows B. Why does Nozir come after Soita? Because Kalaroya Soita Pekilkula Yazir Satsmai Min Hayayin. So Rashi explains the inner sequence between those three blocks, but he doesn't explain what the whole three are doing over here. And the Ramban, by contrast, does take this as a shaila which needs solving, and he tells that as a matter of fact each one of the three mitzvahs does belong over here as a result of what we've been doing in Sefer Bamidbar till now, which is counting the Yidden, dividing them into the Machane, and so on. In what sense? So he says that the Gezel HaGer comes to be Menachem the Gerim, because the Geirah must have felt simply awful. I mean, that's what happened by the Mekallel at the end of Emma. He wants to come to Don, which his mother came from Don, and he felt that was his Shevet. So they told him, no, you can't come. Your father was a Mitzri, and Mimele, you're not Miyuchas to Shevet Don. You can't come over here. So Geirah don't have a place in the Machane. The Geirah apparently had to live in the corners together where the animals were. Must have felt a terrible design for the Geirah. And therefore the Torah had a necessity to comfort them and say, look, you're not second-class citizens. You don't have the Kedusha of the Shvatim. You're not part of the Shvatim. That's a Metzius. But on the other hand, your rights will be scrupulously protected, and you're going when people steal from you, you should know that the justice is going to be done, and you're going to have to give it back, and if you're not around, they have to give it to the Kohen, and so on. So Gezel HaGer over here in order to put the mind of the Gerim at rest. The third Parsha, Nozir, the Ramban says, is because now that the Mishkan is in the midst of the people, so there's no Sofek in the world that there will be Yechidim who want to do a little more than is necessary. They want to practice some asceticism which goes beyond the ordinary. So the Torah has to tell us what the Rebbeinu Shalom wants. You want to shoulder a higher level of Kedusha than an ordinary person? Fine, there is an allowance for that. What do I want you to do? I don't want you to make big tarnesim. I don't want you to gash yourself. I don't want you to put stones in your shoes. Be mazi atzma min hayayin, that does me perfectly. If you can be mazi yourself from the yayin and from tumah and so on, so that's good enough for me, and that is the acceptable form of accepting on yourself a higher level of asceticism. What's Soita doing here? I especially altered the sequence because it's the Soita which is really what's nageya to our discussion over here by Kibbut Afroem. What is Soita doing over here? Dr. Ramban, because of the counting. How did the counting take place? The Mishpachasam, the Beis Avosam, 12 times. The Mishpachasam, the Beis Avosam. So you see that the individual is measured by the Mishpacha to which he belongs. You counted the individual, but you counted the individual and were miyachas him to his Mishpacha. You were miyachas it to Mishpacha. And then the number of the Shevet was made up of the Beis Av. So you see that the unit which makes Klal Yisrael is a unit of Botei Ovas. It's not the individuals which are counted, but how many individuals are there in the Beis Av? And then the Beis Av is the unit with which the Torah deals. So it turns out that the Beis Av is a very, very fundamental issue in Klal Yisrael. It's the unit around which Klal Yisrael is structured. That's the family. And nowadays there's a new word which people use the whole time now. I checked it in the dictionary. It's only since 1947. There's something called the nuclear family. What's the nuclear family? It's got nothing to do with exploding bombs. It has to do with nuclear in the sense. The nucleus is the basis. It's the bottom line thing of what it is. So the nuclear family is a family without any frills. What's a family without frills? Parents and children. That's what a family is. An extended family would be if the cousins live there, if the uncle and aunts live there, but the nuclear family, that means the Etzem family, Bashehu family, that is parents and children. That's the nuclear family. And so that is the unit around which Klal Yisrael is built, and therefore the Torah needed to put in mind a mechanism to protect the integrity of the Beis Av, to know who's a mamzer, who's not a mamzer. These are important things. So therefore the Torah was Mechadish, the Pasha of Saita. So through the Pasha of Saita, the Tzur of the Beis Av can be protected. That's what the reason why it's over here. So that's why I say that Kibud Avraham has to do with Pashas Nosai, because you see according to the Ramban that Pashas Nosai, why does the Pasha of Saita come in here? The Pasha of Saita comes in here as part of the Musak of Beis Av, as a central element in the Binyan of Klal Yisrael. Now, but we have to understand why. Why is the Beis Av? In other words, what is really said when we make the Beis Av the central unit? I mean, the Ramban doesn't go into that, because the Ramban is only interested, why is this Pasha here? So he says, you see that the Beis Av is central, but why is the Beis Av central? What is there about the Beis Av that makes it specifically central? So that, the Ramban doesn't tell us. So that's something which we would have to work out. I saw a Shtickel Torah in Mordechai Miller, Zecher Tzadik Livrocha, the late principal of the Gateshead Jewish Teacher Seminary, the big, big seminary in Gateshead. So Rav Miller was for many years the principal of the seminary, and he gave shiurim every Shabbos. So his second volume of shiurim is called Oilas Shabbos B'Shabbatah, the droshes which he gave to people in Gateshead on Shabbos. And he has a terrific, terrific insight. When I saw this insight, I'm almost, it was just, it boggles the mind, the brilliance of the Zustell that he makes. He talks about this question. There are two things about Matan Torah, Shavuos de Kesugya. There are two things about Matan Torah which interest him very much. One thing is this question of the Vayichan Yisrael betachte soho, that Kofaleim ha-kegigis, that the Rebbein Sholem took the mountain and he put the Yidden underneath the mountain. He suspended the mountain over the Yidden and said in Tekablus HaToyro Mutav Im Lav Toitehe Kuraschem. And everybody asks, the Toysus talks about it, that why did they need this Kofar Aleim HaKegigas? They said Naseh V'Nishma. Yidden had already said Naseh V'Nishma, according to Chazal, who say that the Pasha Mishpatim really happened in Yisrael before Matan Torah. So in Mishpatim it says that it said Naseh V'Nishma. So they said Naseh V'Nishma, so what did you need? Kofar Aleim HaKegigas. So let's leave it open, because it's not so nageya to us. If you want to be ma'ayan in it, look at the Gur Aryeh on the Rashi in Yisro, where he brings this din of Kofalem HaKegigas. The Gur Aryeh explains why it was necessary to have this aspect of kefir by Matan Torah. Very, very interesting. But you saw it, that they needed Kofalem HaKegigas. Another thing, there is in Midrashe Chazal, that when the Rebbein Shlalom gave, the Yalkut brings it, when the Rebbein Shlalom gave the Torah to Yidden, so the Ummas were very, very jealous. They said, why favor the Yidden? Why give them the Torah and not give us the Torah? So the Rebbein Shlom said, you know why? Because the Yidden, I only gave the Torah after they brought the Sifrei Yichuseyim. I needed for them to bring documents or aiders of genealogy to trace them to which family they belong. So you don't have that. You don't have Sifrei Yichus. So since you don't have Sifrei Yichus, so Mimela, I don't give you the Torah. And there is a Chazal, which Rabbi Miller brings, which indicates that there's some connection between these two seemingly disparate inyonim. One, that we needed Kofa Lehem HaKegiges, and the second one is that as a condition of Matan Torah, they had to provide the Sefer Yuchsin. So Miller brings Rayas that the two were connected. Because you needed Kofa Lehem HaKegiges, they needed to produce the Sifrei Yichus. So, Miller, what's one going to do with the other? Yeah, I mean, it's obvious. I mean, none of us understand. So he comes up with such a moiradig in your side. It's so brilliant. But it's really like, it can help us with so many yesiders. He says, moiradig. He says, look, kofalem hakegiges. So you're being kofe them. You're forcing them. What is the value of something that's forced? The guy doesn't mean it. So they say, okay, we're going to accept the Torah. Oh, big deal, you for you. Otherwise I would have said, Shom Tehek Furasrem. What's the point of a forced Kabbalah? So everybody knows the Rambam. That the Rambam says, by get, there's a din by get, that it has to be that the husband gives it from his own will to give the get. If you force him to give a get, the get is possible. No, so what's the din, Taka, if he has to give a get? There are cases where the wife has the right to claim a get, so then, but he's not giving it with his goodwill. So the Gemara says, we force him to say Reitzani. Now what's the good of that? That you force him to say Reitzani. So a forced Reitzani is nothing. So if a forced get is nothing, so how does a forced Reitzani make it better? Zog der Rambam, in Perek Beis Mehilchos Gevurshin, he says this, you saw it, probably most people have heard it, that the pshat is like this. When is a transaction considered forced? If he has no Torah obligation to give it. I have a field, and you want to buy it, and I don't want to sell it, so you twist my arm, or you beat me up, until I say, okay, I'll sell it to you. That's called an onus. That's called an onus, because I don't want to sell it to you. Zog der Heilige Rambam. But where the halacha is mechayev me to do it, where the halacha says I've got to give her this get, so then a yid wants to be a yid, and if a yid wants to be a yid, deep down he wants to do the right thing. As long as he wants to remain a yid, he wants to do the right thing. And what yid doesn't want to do what the Rabbeinu Shlalom tells him to do? Tells his wife, does he say, no, I'm not going to give it? The Tells is the Yetzirah is twisting his arm. The Yetzirah is telling him, I don't want you to do it. The Rabbanshah has no right to make you do that. So the Rambam, when we force him to say Reitzani, what we're forcing is really the Yetzirah. We are forcing the Yetzirah to stop bothering him. Once the Yetzirah stops bothering him and he says Reitzani, he means the Reitzani. He means the Reitzani. Why? Because he's an Elisha Yid. Every Yid is an Elisha Yid. Comes out like this. Why is every Yid an Elisha Yid? People do Aveiros. Yeah, but deep down, there's the Pintal Yid, people say. Right? There's inside, there is the Yerusha which we have from the Ovais. The Yerusha that we have from the Ovais. And the Ovais made us into Kedoshim. They made us into holy people. So many of us have piles and piles and piles of ugliness piled up on top of that Kedusha. But in each one of us, deep down, there is this place of utter goodness, of utter holiness, and that is there, and that never disappears. Mimela, come to Reus like this. So it's very, very good that the Rebbeinu Shem said to the Goyim, look, Matan Torah needs Kofalem HaKegiges. Told you, look in the Gemara and you'll see why. But you need Kofalem HaKegiges. Now, a forced Kabbalah Satorah is not worth anything. Teretz is, I've got to have the Rambam's Teretz. I have to have the Rambam's Teretz that deep down you want the right thing, and therefore you force the Yetzirah, and after the Yetzirah leaves off, so then you Taka want it because you want to be a Yid. But that's us then, because they brought their Sefer Yichus. They brought their Sefer Yichus that they're Meyuchus to the Ovas, to the Shvatim. So Mimelu, Kofa Lehem HaKegiges by them can work. You don't have Sefer Yuchsin. You don't come from the Ovetz. So Mimele, when you refuse because you don't want. So you'd be forced. So what's the point of being Kofalem HaKegiges? You're going to say yes, because you don't want to be Shomtek for us. Huh? But you don't have such a Mayodi Ketushtel to that Rambam. It's just very, very, very beautiful. What I want to use is Yesoid of Rabbi Miller. I want to use it to explain this mitzvah of Kibbut Avraham, why it's in the Aseres HaDibros. Kum toch ois, that when we think about a Yid, when we think about a Yid, so what did we learn in Soita? That the unit with which Klal Yisrael is built is the Mishpacha, which means that my vertical relationships, the son to the father to the son, they are the Iker relationships. Not the horizontal relationships which I have together with my neighbors and my friends and my cousins and my whatever it is. Yeah, so we have relationships. But that's not the Iker Yesoid of Yiddishkeit. The Iker Yesoid of Yiddishkeit is that I'm the son of my father. And if I'm the son of my father, he's the son of his father, and he's the son of his father, and he's the son of his father, ultimately we get back to the Ovos. I think that is the Yesoid, that is the extra halachic. We said that Kibbut Avraham, it's a mitzvah, but mitzvah doesn't make it into a dibra. Teretz is it also a dibra. What makes it a dibra? What is it that makes it as a constitution of Klal Yisrael? Kibbut Avraham means you depend on your father to bring you back to the Ovos. See, and that is, I think, the answer to the question which we started off with, why, if the relationship of the son to the father makes it into the Aseres HaDibros, so why not the mitzvah of Moira Avraham? The answer is because that's the Nakuda. The Nakuda is, why does it make it into the Aseres HaDibros? Because it's through the father, and through his father, and his father, and his father, and his father, that I get back to the Ovos, and that therefore I can be made on my inner core of goodness inside me. And that is why I was Mekabel the Torah. Kum toch ois, that the whole thing is toloi on father-son. But it's not toloi on the moira of father and son. It's toloi on the covet of father and son. Covet means that the father in my eyes is the absolute repository of goodness, of honesty, of ehrlichkeit. Remember the Ramban in Voishanan says that you have to tell your children, says the Ramban. Why? Because the Ramban is not going to make a Mamet Hasina in every time. So you were there, standing there, is there good? But what about your children? The Av is not Meshakel if Noi, says the Ramban. That's Mesoira. You know why we're Maiminim? Because our Tatis told us that we should be Maiminim. That's the word. They're not always biological fathers. Sometimes it's the community which has to stand in locus parentis. But Be'etzem, it's the kibbut which the son has to the father. So the kibbut which the son has to the father is really the building block of Klal Yisrael. Only that made it possible for us to get the Torah. And that is why the mitzvah of Kibbut Avraham, but not the mitzvah of Moira Avraham, makes it into the Aseres HaDibros. If you hear this before Shavuos, it's rather good. If you hear it after Shavuos, it's still time to be in Elohim after Shavuos also. I want to wish all of you a good Yontif, and we should all be zeichet to see many Simchas together.